Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome, friends of Golden Age of Radio. Tonight, we have two shows that are perhaps some of the best-known names in radio history. Our first play, The Lone Ranger, is certainly one of the oldest since he came on the scene in January of 1933. Hey, that's only 78 years ago. Don't laugh, I was there. And his sponsor at the end of that year was Silver Cup Bread. Several actors took on that part, but by 1941, the role belonged to Brace Beamer. The writers were always warned that the Lone Ranger believes that our sacred American heritage provides every individual the right to worship God as he desires. He never makes love on radio, TV, in movies, or in cartoons. He is a man who can fight against great odds, yet take the time to treat a bird with a broken wing. The Lone Ranger never smokes, never uses profanity, and never uses intoxicating beverage. What a guy. The Lone Ranger at all times uses precise speech without slang or dialect. His grammar must be pure. He must make proper use of who and whom, shall and will, I and me. He never shoots to kill. When he has to use his guns, he aims to maim as painlessly as possible. And more instructors to the writers were, play down gambling and drinking scenes as far as possible and keep the Lone Ranger out of saloons. When this cannot be avoided, try to make the saloon a cafe and deal with waiters and food rather than bartenders and liquor. What a hero to all of us kids of yesteryear. There are several accounts of who the masked man really was. Perhaps the most popular is the one that told of how six Texas Rangers chased the Butch Cavendish gang to a final showdown at Bryant's Gap. The Rangers were led by Captain Dan Reed with a younger brother, John, under his command. Their scout Collins betrayed them and they were ambushed from above. All were thought to be killed. When the outlaws left, an Indian came at night and discovered that one of the men was not dead. That man was the younger brother, and he cared for the lone survivor. Then he buried the five, made a sixth grave, leaving it empty. When John Reed came to, he recognized the Indian as a childhood friend whose life he had saved long ago. The name was?
Tonto.
You bet. And although, through all of more than 2,000 episodes of bringing baddies to justice, he never killed anyone, although only one man comes to mind as having died at the hands of the Lone Ranger. This was his deadly enemy, Butch Cavendish, who broke out of the federal prison and finally faced the masked man in a death struggle at Bryant's Gap, the site of the original massacre. Justice eventually prevailed. Enough said. Let us tune in now to one of those 2,000 plus episodes as the radio begins with...
Resourceful masked rider of the plains led the fight for law and order in the early Western United States. Nowhere in the pages of history can one find a greater champion of justice. Return with us now to those thrilling days of yesteryear. From out of the past come the thundering hoofbeats of the great horse Silver. The Lone Ranger rides again.
On Silver, let's go, big fellow. Hail Silver, away!
Dr. Frank Rockford approached a small farmhouse in the foothills, several miles inland from Eagle Pass, Texas.
Ho! Ho there! Ho! Easy!
He stood a moment, waiting, as his 10-year-old daughter, Sally, ran to meet him.
Hello, Daddy.
Hi.
Did you bring me something from town?
No, Sally, not this time.
Aww.
Maybe next time, honey. You run along and play. I have to talk to your mother.
All right, Daddy.
Frank, I didn't expect you back from Milton so soon.
I didn't stay, Mary. I don't know how long I'll be able to go on like this.
I know how you must feel, dear. Sometimes I wonder if running away was the thing to do.
No one in this territory knows I'm a doctor. They think of me as a small farmer. By now, they must know I'm not a very good farmer from the little I managed to make. I saw a handbill in front of the marshal's office this morning. It said, "Wanted on suspicion of murder, Dr. Rockford."
Oh!
Clean shaven, medium height, blue eyes.
But no one would recognize you with that heavy beard and with a different name.
Well, perhaps not. But it was a shock reading that handbill. And even though we've convinced Sally our name is now Frankford and that I'm a farmer, I'm always afraid she may run into somebody and make a slip.
Frank, we know you didn't kill anyone.
The facts were against me, Mary. I couldn't stay in Kansas City and face a trial.
I almost wish you had, Frank. We can raise enough here to feed us, but our savings are gone. And we'll not be able to meet the payments on the farm. I know how worried you are, but maybe if you gave yourself up...
No! No, I can't do it. I'll manage somehow. As long as you stick by me, I'll go to work in the field.
That afternoon, the Lone Ranger and his Indian companion, Tonto, headed south toward Eagle Pass and the Rio Grande. As they approached the entrance to the doctor's farm, Tonto pointed and spoke.
Look, Kemosabe, little girl near trail. There, small dog on ground.
The dog seems to be hurt. We'll stop a moment. Whoa, Silver, easy.
Whoa, Scout.
Hello there, little girl. What's the matter with your dog? Steady, Silver, steady.
Golly, a masked man.
Don't be afraid. Is your dog hurt?
No, I'm playing doctor. But Rags won't lie still. All right, Rags, you can get up now.
Where did you get that doctor's bag? That's not a toy.
Oh, no, it's real. I found it in Daddy's closet.
May I look at it?
Sure, here.
Thanks. Is your father a doctor?
He's a farmer. He told me so.
What's your name, little girl?
Sally Frankford.
There's a card glued inside the bag. Dr. Frank Rockford. The doctor must have left this with your father.
I don't know. I found it in the closet.
Well, I'm sure your father wouldn't want you to use these instruments, Sally. Perhaps you'd better take the bag back and put it where you found it. Here.
All right, mister. Is he a wild Indian?
No, me plenty tame, Sally.
Tonto is my friend, Sally.
Do you always wear a mask?
Well, most of the time, but never mind the mask. Take the bag back before your father misses it.
All right. Come on, Rags. Bye.
Steady, big fellow.
Easy, Scout. Easy, fella.
Strange, a farmer would have a doctor's kit in the house, Tonto. All right, let's go. I want to reach Eagle Pass by sundown. Come on, Silver.
Get him up, Scout.
Outskirts of Eagle Pass and stopped to make camp, a steady rain was falling.
Whoa, Silver, whoa.
Whoa, Scout.
Sorry, big fellow.
Easy, Scout.
We'll build a lean-to, Tonto, for shelter.
Rain needed plenty much. It been dry a long time.
Yes, I hope it rains enough to do some good. Let's get busy, Tonto.
Thank you.
hope was not in vain. The rain continued to fall heavily for the next 3 days. The morning of the third day, Tonto returned from a trip into town.
Me bring back handbills from town, Kemosabe. Here.
I'll look them over. One on the outlaw, Tex Logan. Last we heard of him, he was up near El Paso.
Ah, that right.
Here's one about an escaped prisoner thought to be in Stockton territory. The third one is about a doctor from Kansas City wanted as a murder suspect. A Dr. Rockford. Tonto will go... Wait. The name Dr. Rockford was on that card in the medical kit we saw the little girl playing with a few days ago.
Oh, that's right.
Tonto, the rain is letting up. We'll ride up the river trail first and search for that escaped prisoner. Then we'll go back to that farm near Milton and have a talk with Sally's father.
Ah, good idea.
We'll leave right now. Perhaps by noon the rain will have stopped. All right, let's get the horses.
Later, as the two men rode up the Rio Grande Trail, the rain stopped falling. The Lone Ranger was saying,
Tonto, though the rain has stopped, I've noticed something.
What then?
The water in the Rio Grande seems to be rising steadily. I don't like it.
It's still far down from top of bank.
Yes, I know. But I remember a few years ago, after a prolonged rain, when the river fed by streams from the mountainous region to the north reached flood proportions.
I may remember.
The terrain around Eagle Pass and on down from there is fairly flat. If the waters do rise enough to overflow the bank of the river, many lives will be endangered. Whoa, Silver, whoa!
Whoa, Scout.
Tonto, I don't think the people there will realize the danger.
What we do?
We'll go back and warn them before it's too late. Come on, Silver!
Get him up, Scout!
It was dark when the Lone Ranger and Tonto rode along a back street and stopped at the sheriff's office in Eagle Pass. The masked man identified himself to the sheriff, then convinced him that there was a danger of a flood within a short time. The sheriff, with a worried expression on his face, asked,
Great day, mister. What'll we do? What do you suggest?
I suggest the women and children be sent to higher ground in all available wagons. Then the men must build a dike of sandbags along the riverbank bordering the town. Above and below the town, the canyon walls are high enough to retain the floodwaters.
Good idea. The riverbank is low only where it borders the town. A sandbag dike should keep us from being flooded.
And someone should be sent to warn the people of Laredo.
I'll send a deputy to warn them. Let's go talk to the folks down by the river.
Right.
Most of the citizens of the town were lined along the riverbank, watching the turbulent waters.
Hey, look! The sheriff with a masked man and Injun.
Now listen, everybody. These are friends.
Friends?
You can take my word for that. They came here to warn us of danger.
What danger?
I'll let the masked man tell you that. Listen to what he has to say.
People, there's no time to lose. The water will rise much higher. There's danger of a flood here in Eagle Pass and south of here, too.
The rain stopped, mister. The water will be going down before long.
No, you're wrong. The water will drain from the hills. The flood crest will come later, I'm sure of it. We must take the women and children to high ground and build a levee of sandbags. We must act now or it will be too late.
Hey, look! Look up the river! Big wave coming down this way.
The first flood crest, and it will be followed by a bigger one. Hurry! Get the women and children out of town. Eagle Rock may soon be underwater.
The skepticism of the crowd vanished when they saw the threatening crest of water moving down toward them. The first crest passed, leaving the water lapping over the top of the riverbank. The Lone Ranger averted panic by putting the men to work, evacuating the women and children and filling sandbags for a levee. A line of wagons left the town, headed toward the hills. The men who stayed behind worked frantically to build a retaining wall of sandbags along the low section of the riverbank before the expected large flood crest arrived. A full moon shone brightly on the hard-working men as they toiled through the night. Mexicans from a small settlement of Piedras Negras streamed across the wooden bridge from the Mexican side of the river by wagon and burro. Toward morning, the Lone Ranger spoke to the sheriff.
Sheriff, the bridge better be closed to prevent loss of life. The water's washing over it and may go out.
Yeah, I reckon you're right. I think most everybody who wanted to cross has come over. I'll notify the bridge guards.
A short time later, one of the townspeople pointed to the bridge and shouted excitedly.
Oh, hey, look! Look, the bridge is shaking like it's gonna give away! And there's an old Mexican trying to walk across! He won't make it!
He's clinging to the bridge rail! He'll go down with the bridge!
That man needs help.
Nobody can reach him, mister. That bridge is about to go out!
I'll try to get him.
Wait, you can't make it!
Easy, steady, big fellow. Come on, Silver!
Urging the great horse Silver forward, the masked man quickly reached the shaky bridge.
Easy, Silver. Easy, boy.
The people along the riverbank watched tensely as the Lone Ranger rode toward the center of the bridge, where the old Mexican, panic-stricken, clung to the bridge railing.
Hang on, I'll help you. Come on, Silver.
A few minutes later, he reached the old man's side.
Whoa, Silver, whoa. I'll help you climb up behind me. Now hurry.
Oh, gracias, senor. But it's no use.
Give me your hand. Don't give up. Here.
The bridge, shoot it, go.
We'll try to get ashore before it goes. Hang on tightly. Come on, Silver. Easy, big fellow. We must make it.
Risking certain death, the Lone Ranger guided the great stallion carefully back toward Eagle Pass. The crowd watched spellbound as rumble after rumble told of the imminent destruction of the wooden structure. Then, just as Silver reached the end of the bridge...
Look out! There it goes!
Whoa, Silver, whoa! I'll help you down. There. Easy, steady, big fellow.
Mia gracia, senor. You saved my life.
By thunder, I never thought you'd make it. If you'd been a minute later...
Hey, look! Over there!
Great day, look! A wall of water coming down the river.
The flood crest. I hope it pry that mummy home.
Keep back, everybody!
The sandbags held as the flood crest passed, leaving the water level higher than ever. All that day, the men worked stopping leaks and strengthening the levee with more sandbags. The following morning, the waters were receding slowly when one of the men who had gone to take the women and children to safety rode to find the sheriff.
Whoa, over there, whoa. Sheriff, an epidemic of the fever has broken out at the big temporary camp we made in the hills.
What?
We gotta find a doctor.
Only doctor I know is in Laredo, and they're likely having their own troubles. Anyway, we couldn't get through to him there. What do you think we ought to do, mister?
We'll go and do what we can for them, Sheriff. Of course, without proper medication, the situation may become desperate. Where is the camp located?
Well, about a mile from Milton, back in the foothills.
Let's go, Tonto.
Come on, let's go.
I'll go with you.
Easy, steady, big fella.
Giddy up.
Come on, Silver!
Doctor's farm on the way to the camp near Milton.
Easy, Silver. Easy.
Easy, boy. Easy.
Hey,
yes?
There where we see little girl with dog of the day. Her playing doctor.
Yeah, she had a doctor's kit and...
Where'd she get a doctor's kit?
She said it belonged to her father, a farmer. I didn't question her further, but I... Tonto, you and the sheriff ride on. I'll join you later. and I may bring a doctor with me. I'm going to stop at that farmhouse. Come on, Silver!
Get him up, Scout.
Get him up there. Get him.
A short time later, the Lone Ranger knocked on the door of the farmhouse.
A masked man! What?
Please forget the mask. I've come to talk to you. A matter of life and death.
Well, come in.
Thank you.
Who is it, Frank? Oh, a masked man!
Don't be frightened.
Why have you come here?
To talk to you, Dr. Rockford.
Doctor, he called you...
Let me handle this, Mary. Mister, I don't know who you are, but my name is Frankford, and I'm a farmer.
I saw your little girl playing with a doctor's bag a few days ago. The name Dr. Rockford was in it.
I don't know where she'd get such a thing.
She said it was yours. Also, I read a handbill about a Dr. Rockford. Frank Rockford of Kansas City. Middle-aged, clean-shaven. Of course, it would be simple to grow that beard as a disguise.
I don't know anything about Dr. Rockford. My name is Frankford.
Oh? Well, I'm sorry to hear it. You've heard about the flood, of course, and about the people camped in the hills near town.
Yes, we saw the wagons passing and heard the awful news.
An epidemic has broken out in the camp. Many may die unless they have a doctor's help.
Oh!
I was hoping you are Dr. Rockford. I know all doctors take an oath to save lives. The situation is desperate.
Frank, you must help them, you must!
Then you are Dr. Rockford.
Yes, I am. I left Kansas City because I was to be charged with a murder I didn't commit. A patient, a woman, died after an operation. Her husband threatened to kill me. He was found dead on the trail, ambushed, and a gun belonging to me was found nearby. Someone took it from my office. I didn't do it. I left town to avoid arrest.
I understand. Will you come to the camp with me, Doctor? They need you very much.
Yes, I'll go. And later I'll give myself up to the authorities. I'll get my medical kit and we'll leave at once.
The Lone Ranger and the doctor rode hurriedly to the temporary camp.
Whoa, Silver. Whoa, good fellow.
Howdy, mister. I've been waiting for you.
Sheriff, I brought a doctor.
Well, thank heaven. Glad to see you, Doc.
Hello, Sheriff. I'll get right to work.
If there's anything I can do.
I have a small amount of medicine to combat the fever, but I'll need much more.
Doctor, I suggest you write down the name of the medicine you want. Then have the sheriff go into Milton and telegraph San Antonio for a supply. It can be sent by special courier.
We must get it here as soon as possible.
Just write down what you want, Doc. I'll get it off by telegraph within a half an hour.
The doctor's limited supply barely lasted until the medicine arrived from San Antonio. The Lone Ranger and Tonto, under the doctor's directions, helped to give medication to the stricken people and to relieve the suffering. For 3 days and nights, they worked unceasingly with very little rest. Finally, the doctor spoke encouragingly.
Mister, I think I can safely say the situation is well in hand now.
Good, you've done a wonderful job, Doctor.
Oh, here comes the sheriff. I think it's about time he learned the truth about me.
Hold there. Steady there. Well, Doctor, thanks to you, things seem to be coming along fine. The folks sure are beholden to you and the masked man.
Thanks, Sheriff. There's something you ought to know.
Oh, I got some good news for you too, Doc.
News? For me?
Uh-huh. The masked man believed in you, so I went into Milton last night and sent a telegram. Just got the answer. Here it is. Listen. Sheriff Fields, care of Milton office. Dr. Rockford, no longer wanted by the law.
What?
Real murderer apprehended. Signed, Marshall Billings, Kansas City.
I'm no longer a fugitive from justice?
Nope. You're free to go on your way, Doc.
I don't know what to say. Why, well, now we'll give up the farm and I'll practice again.
I'm very happy for you, Doctor. I think the people of Eagle Pass would like to have you settle there.
They sure would. How about it, Doc?
I'd like that. This is a wonderful country.
Yep. Thanks to you, the water didn't do too much damage. As soon as possible, we'll move these folks back to their homes.
Good. Tano's waiting over there with our horses. We'll meet you again, Doctor. Adios.
Goodbye, mister.
Goodbye.
Easy, big fellow. Come on, Silver!
Sheriff, I've met many men in my life, but he's the finest and most understanding man I've ever met. Who is he?
What? I thought you knew by this time, Doc. He's an armory who always puts his country and other people first, regardless of the risk. You see? He's the Lone Ranger.
Earl Silver, away!
As our hero goes galloping away with his great horse, Silver, he leaves behind our cast members in the dust, who are all grateful for his bringing law and order into their lives. As the Lone Ranger himself, we have Dave Sanchi, of course. He'd have no one to talk to unless Tonto, his faithful Native American companion, came along, as played by Roger Morris. Dr. Frankford Rockford, the wrongfully accused medicine man who saved the whole town from the fever, was played by Jay Summerfield. Along with his faithful, ever-loving wife in the story, Sue Gazinski. Their charming little girl, who played with her daddy's doctor bag, was Judy Marsh. Along came the sheriff, that was Andre Dixon. And the man who nearly drowned as the bridge collapsed, but did not, thanks to the wonder horse Silver, that was John Shefke. Who also changed his ethnic accent and became one of the town regulars. Other voices of the townspeople belong to Nell Brennan, and Donna Amesmeyer. And, oh yes, our resident barking dog, that again was Jay Summerfield. Our hardworking sound people were Tom Lentz and Dana Amesmeyer. Donna Amesmeyer. With extra music provided by Marianne Sadalek. And this is your announcer, Walt Kovalik, speaking. In just a moment, we'll be broadcasting our second program of the evening, but first, a word from Ellie Babka.
I'll bet when Rossini composed that overture to William Tell, never in his wildest dreams did he think it would become famous among kids all over the world, who would worship a masked man riding a great white horse. Ah, yes, those thrilling but innocent days of the golden age of radio. We now come, incidentally, Marianne has come up with an unbelievably long list off the internet of classical music that was very often used as introductions or as background music for many, many shows. We're probably not even aware of it. We're talking pieces by Mozart and Beethoven and, of course, Rossini. We really aren't aware of it because this music just gives it such an extra mood and while the story's going on. So next time you're listening to something, even cartoons, the Bugs Bunny cartoons used a lot of classical music. And this list that Marianne has not only lists the composer and the piece that was played, but whether it was used for happy music or something that was a murdering tremolo in the background. And it's really interesting. I really should have brought it and read some of those things. Okay, we